Juliet, Juliet, where art thou, Juliet? What the frick?
Next on our list, we bring you poet Byron Yang. He has written over 50 poems during his lifetime, all of which have been epic. He rivals Homer's Odyssey, in fact, as he says so himself. He loves nature and often dances around with it every day. But he is here today to talk to us about poetry and rhyme during the Renaissance.
Three types of poetry evolved from the Renaissance, called sonnets, cavalier poetry, and metaphysical poetry. The sonnet had three different types during the Renaissance, consisting of Italian slash Petrarchan, English Spenserian, and the English Shakespearean sonnets. All the sonnets were most commonly found in the iambic pentameter, but there were rare oddities, which consisted of tetrameter or even hexameter sonnets. The Petrarchan sonnet is the first of three sonnets and was divided into two sections called the octave and the sestet. The octave was 8 lines in A-B-B-A-A-B-B-A. Then the sestet was the last 6 lines done in a variety of ways, which could make up 2 or 3 rhymes a line. Elizabethan poets favored Petrarchan sonnets because they used conventional comparisons, but the sonnets started dying out because of being overuse and being made fun of. The English Spenserian sonnet is a 14-line sonnet that is done in just one section and goes A-B-A-B-B-C-B-C-C-D-C-D-E-E. The last and most famous of the sonnets is the Shakespearean sonnet. This type of sonnet is done in 14 lines and is considered the easiest of all sonnets because it is done in a simple 3 quatrains and 1 couplet at the end, going A-B-A-B-C-D-C-D-E-F-E-E-F-G-G. The difference in these sonnets and the reason why they have different names is because they have different rhyme schemes by different people. Each one doesn't represent a different characteristic or feel that has to be conveyed through the sonnet. They are just done in a different way. Cavalier poetry was from the late Renaissance and was a form of very polite, courtly poetry that was neat and didn't express too much emotion. The poetry had a gracious, melodious, courteous tone and meter. Cavalier poetry had many different characteristics that included being epigrammic and witty, licentious and cynical, and had the frequent theme of carpe diem, living in the present. While much poetry could be written for a variety of things and didn't need to be for anything specific, cavalier poetry was usually written for a particular occasion, like a poem for courting someone. Metaphysical poetry was very different in that it was trying to challenge conventional imagery through paradoxes. The poetry used as a kind of rebellion against the ordinary. Poets often wrote as very dramatic characters and included much self-expression that could be emitted through erratic meters and stanzas. The poetry would take knowledge from wide arrays of topics, use a clever tone and extensive comparisons to emphasize its rejection of anything overly romantic. Done.
Yeah!
Architect Michael Tompkins has been around for a long time, 15 years to be exact. He has designed many buildings, from the Twin Towers to the Golden Gate Bridge. He is here to talk to us about buildings during the Renaissance and what lifestyles was like back then.
In Shakespeare's time, homes varied greatly according to wealth. The poor made do with whatever they had. Those who lived in the city often lived above their shops in timber-framed houses, despite the fire risk. The rich, on the other hand, built enormous palaces that dwarfed any other building in England. With the advent of chimneys and fireplaces, residents gained the ability to build smaller rooms, which allowed for multiple-story homes. Luxuries also became accessible. Decorative caps were often placed on chimneys, and fireplaces usually had decorative mantles. As far as traditions go, citizens usually had 3 meals a day: breakfast, dinner, and supper. Dinner was what we now call lunch. Another much less pleasant tradition was the execution of criminals. Those of noble birth were mercifully beheaded, which is to cause them almost no pain. Those less fortunate, on the other hand, were either burned at stake for treason or religious crimes, or hanged, drawn, and quartered. This involved half-hanging somebody and cutting them into 4 pieces while they were still alive. Then the pieces were distributed throughout the city as a warning to other criminals.
From UCLA College, we bring you Professor Justin Jay. He's a professional librarian and is here to talk to us about information transfer during the Renaissance.
The
Renaissance, forms of communication were beginning to diversify. Information transfer included forms of writing letters, manuscripts, and books. Books were especially hard to duplicate, but Johann Gutenberg made this possible with the movable printing press and type. Consequently, this led to more people becoming literate and able to understand the written language. With the movable printing press, written information spread to all areas of the Renaissance. Pamphlets became very common in spreading this information, and even common with propaganda. But most of all, pamphlets regarding religion became the core of Renaissance thought, with individuals taking part in transfer of information. Thinkers like William Tyndale and Martin Luther translated the Bible into several languages, like German and English, and it truly allowed information to reach a global audience. At any given moment, information was being transferred from one place to another at speeds exponentially greater than the Middle Ages. Trade routes, caravans, translated information, and documents all spurred new thought and critiques from other authors. Authors during the Renaissance wrote a great deal more than their respective earlier counterparts. Topics were diverse in many areas, and many manuscripts were in the area of non-fiction writing. During the Renaissance, individuals started to drift away from the thought that God was the supreme being and they were there only for Him. And this included with non-fiction writing. Authors like Niccolo Machiavelli and Erasmus began to question the authority of the Roman Catholic Church and the sincerity of their own government. Many of their non-fiction writing, like Erasmus in The Praise of Folly and Thomas More's Utopia, and Machiavelli's The Prince, had those certain topics in mind. Renaissance ideology allowed those non-fiction writings to be more brutally honest and to the point, and this allowed a new thought process throughout the European community. And in turn, it began to question the Catholic Church and bring what historians call the Protestant Reformation.
It can be used to turn to composition that looks like crap. I, being a musician myself, am going to use this hat as a soapbox. He got it. Leonardo began his career working for. He invented many clever machines and even designed imitations of wings that he thought could make a man fly.
All the places where sculptures were used. And Jason's noodles hitting me! Jason, you're a fool, man. You're a fool. Why are you standing over there? You have to come over here or else the camera's going to die or something. Yes. Jason!
This is my best masterpiece.
ABBA. Oh crap. The sun has started dying out because of overuse and being made fun of. And goes ABABBCBCCDC.
So slow. Those of noble birth were mercifully hanged. Another one hanged. Than more any other building.
During the Renaissance, forms of communication were beginning to diversify.
Fire!